My dear students, assalamu alaikum and welcome to your online class. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the mechanism of action of protein hormones. This topic is not only important for written and viva, but it is also very interesting. So let's start. I'm going to start with looking at this diagram and let's try to understand this diagram. Here we can see that this is a receptor. This is a membrane receptor, and we know that protein hormones have their receptors in or on the surface of the cell membrane. Now this receptor, as you can see, it has three parts. One is the extracellular part, and then this is the transmembrane part that is embedded in the cell membrane, and the intracellular or cytoplasmic part. The extracellular part binds with the hormone, and the transmembrane part, there are seven loops that are spanning the membrane. So this transmembrane part is anchoring the receptor to the cell membrane. And then the intracellular part, this is the cytoplasmic tail. So this is the three parts of our cell membrane receptor. Next, another structure, it is the G protein. G protein is a membrane bound structure. So this membrane bound complex structure is attached to the cell membrane, and it has three subunits: the alpha subunit, the beta subunit, and the gamma subunit. And the alpha subunit is attached with GDP. This is guanosine diphosphate. And when alpha subunit is attached to GDP, it is the inactive state. And when alpha subunit binds with GTP, that is the active state. So we have three structures here. One is the cell membrane. And in the cell membrane, we have the receptor for the protein hormone. And this is the receptor, cell membrane receptor, and we have a G protein that is a complex structure which has three subunits. Now let's see what happens in the next stage. In the next stage, the hormone is coming and it is bound with the receptor. So when the hormone binds with the receptor, it forms the hormone receptor complex, and this activates the receptor. When the receptor is activated, there is a conformational change in the receptor, and the G protein now goes and binds with the cytoplasmic tail of the receptor. One function is this: the G protein binds with the cytoplasmic tail of the receptor, and G protein also replaces GDP with GTP. Okay, so two things are happening here. G protein goes and binds with the cytoplasmic tail of the receptor, and G protein exchange GDP for GTP. So GDP is exchanged with GTP. Now when G protein and GTP is attached with the alpha subunit of the G protein. So when G protein is attached with the GTP, then the alpha subunit, now what it does, it dissociates with the other two subunits. Dissociate means it leaves the other two subunits, and the alpha subunit goes and binds with another protein. Okay, so you see here that here the three subunits, the alpha subunit dissociates and it goes and binds with another protein, and this another protein is a intracellular enzyme, that is the adenylyl cyclase enzyme. And the other two subunits of the G protein goes and binds with the cell membrane. So a lot of things are happening here. First, we have a cell membrane receptor and a G protein, and then the hormone comes and binds with the cell membrane receptor, activates the receptor, and then G protein goes and binds with the cytoplasmic tail of the receptor. Then G protein also exchanges GDP for GTP. Now G protein, the alpha subunit of the G protein, dissociates from this structure and it goes and binds with adenylyl cyclase enzyme, that is another intracellular protein. Now let's see what happens next. When the alpha subunit comes and binds with adenylyl cyclase enzyme, then this catalyzes the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. So ATP is now converted to cyclic AMP. Remember that protein hormones use the second messenger system, adenylyl cyclase, cyclic AMP, second messenger system. So now ATP is converted to cyclic AMP. Another substance that is here, that is a protein kinase. This is another very important enzyme in intracellularly. And this protein kinase is cyclic AMP dependent. And we have an inactive cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. Cyclic AMP dependent means this protein kinase only becomes activated when there is cyclic AMP. So this cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase now becomes activated by this cyclic AMP. So now it is a active cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. See all these adjectives here. It is now active, it is cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. So this protein kinase, what it does is it phosphorylates other intracellular enzymes, and that then initiates a cascade of reactions and is responsible for the cellular response to this hormone. So now this protein kinase, it phosphorylates proteins. Phosphorylate means it adds a phosphate group to other proteins. So when it adds a phosphate group, where is that phosphate group coming from? The phosphate group is coming from ATP. So ATP is the donor who donates a phosphate group. And when ATP donates a phosphate group, it becomes ADP. And the protein receives the phosphate and it is protein phosphate. Now this happens, when this happens, this leads to the cellular responses. And that cellular responses that the hormone wants. So this is how the protein hormones are acting. Now we will see step by step how these structures are playing the role. The first structure that we talked about was the hormone receptor. And this hormone receptor is called G-protein-linked hormone receptor. G-protein-linked hormone receptor has three parts, as we have already seen. There is an extracellular part that binds with the hormone, a transmembrane part that includes seven transmembrane segments that loop in and out of the cell membrane. Then an intracellular part or cytoplasmic tail that is coupled to the G proteins. When the hormone binds with the extracellular part of the receptor, a conformational change occurs in the receptor that activates the G proteins and induces intracellular signals. So this is about our receptor. Now let's know about the G protein. So G protein, its full name is heterotrimeric GTP binding protein, and it is a membrane bound complex, as we have already seen. It has three subunits, alpha, beta and gamma subunits. As there are three subunits, so the name is tri. Tri means three, so it is a trimeric. It is a heterotrimeric GTP binding protein. And the trimeric G proteins are named for their ability to bind guanosine nucleotides. So you can understand the name from here, that it is trimeric because it has three subunits. It is G protein because it has the ability to bind the guanosine nucleotides, that is GTP and GDP. In the inactive state, the three subunits form a complex where GDP is attached to the alpha subunit. GDP means guanosine diphosphate. And in the active state, GTP is attached to the alpha subunit. And G proteins are of two types. One is a stimulatory G protein and another one is inhibitory G protein. Stimulatory G protein is denoted by GS proteins and inhibitory G proteins are denoted as GI proteins. So, now let us look at the important enzyme, that is the protein kinase enzyme. It is an enzyme that phosphorylates other cellular proteins or enzymes, and this is called phosphorylation. Phosphorylate means it adds a phosphate group, and the donor of the phosphate group is ATP, which is then converted to ADP. And another important criteria is that protein kinases are cyclic AMP dependent. So now let us look at the steps of mechanism of protein hormones. First, protein hormone binds with their specific receptors in the cell membrane and forms a hormone receptor complex. The receptor becomes activated. When the receptor is activated, it undergoes a conformational change that causes the G protein to bind with the cytoplasmic part of the receptor and exchange GDP for GTP. Displacement of GDP by GTP causes the alpha subunit to dissociate from the intracellular signaling proteins such as a membrane bound enzyme adenylyl cyclase. So this point, number 3 point, you remember carefully. It says that displacement of GDP by GTP causes the alpha subunit to dissociate from the trimeric complex, and then the alpha subunit goes and associates with other intracellular signaling proteins such as a membrane bound enzyme, and that is the adenylyl cyclase enzyme. Next, what happens? Next, the stimulation of adenylyl cyclase catalyzes the conversion of ATP into cyclic AMP, as we have already seen. So, adenylyl cyclase now catalyzes the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. This activates the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase, which phosphorylates specific proteins in the cell, and this leads to cellular response to the hormone. Now, what are the cellular response? The cellular responses can be such as new protein synthesis, change the activity of an enzyme in the cytoplasm, cell secretion, opening and closing of an ion channel, cell growth and division, and change in the cell permeability. So when we are saying that this is the cellular response, there can be many different types of cellular responses. These are all the cellular responses. And then we have this diagram, as we have already explained. So remember this part, that adenylyl cyclase catalyzes the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. And then we have a protein kinase which is cyclic AMP dependent and it is inactive. So when we have cyclic AMP, then this cyclic AMP makes this protein kinase active. So it now becomes an active cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase which catalyzes the phosphorylation of other proteins and ultimately leads to cellular response. So for written, you have to write from here that mechanism of action of protein hormones, these 6 steps you have to write for this, and you have to give this diagram. So this is how our protein hormones are functioning in our body. And then how this signaling is terminated, how this function comes to an end. There are 3 ways. One is removal of the hormone. The hormone is removed from the binding site. Then secondly, the alpha subunit inactivates itself by converting its bound GTP to GDP. And then the alpha subunit once again combines with beta and gamma subunits to form an inactive membrane bound trimeric G protein. So when alpha subunit is bound to GDP, it becomes inactive. We know that. So, alpha subunit itself converts the GTP to GDP. And then another, the third step is the enzyme phosphodiesterase inactivates cyclic AMP. As protein kinases are cyclic AMP dependent, so when if we can inactivate the cyclic AMP, the hormonal actions will come to an end. And cyclic AMP is inactivated by the enzyme phosphodiesterase. So this is all about the mechanism of action of protein hormones. So thanks for today, and Allah Hafiz.